Good morning, everybody, and welcome to your service. My name is Richard Darmody. You may recall that I've been here before. Eleanor is on holiday this Sunday. We pray for her that she'll have a time of rest and recuperation. Our first hymn, Praise the Lord, Ye Heavens Adore Him, is number 761. If you're able to stand, we stand to sing 761. Truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Glory. our first reading. Reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. For to me, living is Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labour for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you, or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing. For he has graciously granted you the privilege, not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have. This is the God reading. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Psalms on page 475 and Psalm 145.
Thank you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. He sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon, and about 3 o'clock he did the same, and about 5 o'clock he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last work only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose for what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you like to be seated? Just want to check. That's all now, isn't it? Well, I can. Are you envious because I am generous? Matthew chapter 20. And verse 15. Are you envious because I am generous? That the world ought to be a fair place. Go back to the playground. Is not fair. Or to the classroom. Sir, miss, that's not fair. And we carry those ideas through to our adulthood so that there's nothing so irritating when we see someone queue jumping in the shop. Or if it's on the road, it's possible that it will turn to road rage. And families become fragmented and fall out because of something that happened in the past which didn't seem to be fair play. Perhaps somebody feels that the will wasn't distributed fairly. And then there's the sports world. We're now into the world of VAR, so that the outcome of the football game can be deemed to be a fair result. And the same goes for rugby. Perhaps you've been watching the Rugby World Cup. Well, it goes for rugby and it goes for tennis as well. We now know whether the ball is inside the line, on the line, or outside. We don't have to have John McEnroe saying, "I cannot believe it," or "You can't be serious." But there are times when God himself doesn't seem to be fair. And that's what we have in our gospel reading, Matthew chapter 20. Does he seem unjust to give the same amount to the person who came last as the person who came first? Let's recall the story. There is this landowner who has a vineyard. And as was the custom then, early morning he would go into the marketplace and find some men who were standing around waiting to be hired for the day so that they could earn a wage for their family. Early morning he speaks to a gang of men and he says to them, "Will you agree to work for me for the whole day for one Roman coin, for a denarius?" And they said yes, and he takes them and they begin to work on the vineyard. Because the crop is still not coming in quickly enough, the landowner goes out at least two more times into the marketplace in the course of the day, and he invites others to come and work in the vineyard. Come the last hour, the 11th hour, there's still work to be done. So again, the landowner goes into the marketplace and he hires at the 11th hour a group of men who are standing there, and they work in his vineyard. Then, as was the custom, at the end of the day, the wages are given out. The landowner comes and he calls first those who have worked only 1 hour. And how much does he give them? A denarius. "Are good," those men are thinking who started right early morning. "He's going to give us more." But when their turn comes, he gives them the same as he gave to the person who worked only 1 hour. Again, that doesn't sound fair, and those who have worked and borne the heat and burden of the day tell him so. "We have worked all day, and you have given us exactly the same amount, a denarius, as you gave to those who have worked only 1 hour. Life just isn't fair." They thought they were going to get more. This is, in this parable, a picture of God. What is your picture of God? Some of us are a bit old and will remember Monty Python and perhaps remember the beginning of the program where a great big boot came down from heaven and squashed those who were beneath. And that is some people's idea of God. God is not fair. God squashes everything about life which seems to be fair and to be good. But what we learn about God, about the Lord, in this story, is that he is generous. "Are you jealous?" he says, "because I am so generous." I'll show you how that works out in a moment. But there are two more places in the Bible, at least, where there is something similar, where we see the generosity of God. If we'd had an Old Testament reading this morning, it would have been from the book of Jonah. Jonah was an Old Testament prophet of the Lord. He was used to working around Israel and bringing the word of the Lord to God's own people. But one day he believes that God is telling him to go not to his own people, but to go to Nineveh. Nineveh consisted of the sworn enemies of Israel. Why should he go there and tell them about the compassion of God? It's just not fair. They don't deserve it. It would be a bit like God saying to a Ukrainian padre, "Go to the front line of the Russian troops and tell them that God loves them and that he is a God of compassion." We instinctively feel that's not right. You go back to the Second World War and imagine a British padre being sent to the Nazis to say, "God wants to show you compassion." It just doesn't seem right. And you can apply that to the story of Nineveh. Why should we go to those who were killing his own people, his own tribe's people, and talk to them about their need for repentance? And if they do, then God will be merciful towards them. You know how the story goes, and the story of the big fish, and in the end, Jonah reluctantly goes to these people. And it happens that way. He preaches to them, the sworn enemies repent, and God shows them love and compassion. And Jonah explodes in anger, and he says, "This is why I didn't want to come here, because I knew you were a God of compassion and generosity, and that you would do this to these unworthy people." And Jonah sulks and wishes that he were dead, because he didn't want to serve a God who was so generous. Let me take you to a second story where the generosity of God is writ large. It's the story in the New Testament, which Jesus told, the story of the prodigal son. The son who takes his inheritance and wastes it in a distant land, and then comes home regretful that he had lost the money. And there's the elder brother who is there and says to the father, "Do not receive this your son back again, because he has squandered your living in such an outrageous way, and you ought to send him away. Send him away with his tail between his legs." But the father has been waiting for the prodigal return, and he runs towards him, something that was very undignified in those days for a man of this status to run. He takes up his robes and he runs towards his son and he embraces him. There's a wonderful painting by Rubens of this very scene where the bedraggled son is on his knees and the blind father is placing his arms around his son. And the way that Rubens has painted it is like this, that one hand is the hand of a man and the other hand is the hand of a woman. Because the compassion of God is both strong and gentle, it is manly, it is feminine. And he takes his son into his heart, and even though the elder brother doesn't agree, he shows him great compassion. The elder brother graded himself as we sometimes grade ourselves. I am better than that person. I am better than the asylum seeker. I am better than those strangers. I am better than the poor. I deserve preferential treatment. Whereas we have a God who is full of compassion and loving kindness and is indiscriminate in his love. Let me try and draw this to a conclusion by just giving you one more point. There is that, did you notice that those strange words, the first shall be last or the last first? And it comes twice, one at the beginning of the story and one at the end. The first shall be last and the last first. And sometimes people, if they're curious, ask you, what on earth does that mean? Well, it means different things in different contexts. But let me tell you about what it means here in Matthew chapter 20. And I tell it by relating another story. When I was in Paris Ministry a few years ago, during my wife and I were invited to go to Uganda. We were invited by the Bishop of North Kagezi Diocese, and we went and were overwhelmed by the degree of poverty that we encountered. And here's one example of it. We went to see a school at a place called Chabagashi. And in this country, we expect a certain standard in schools. There in this one classroom, the ground was earth and dust. The desks were broken, and there weren't many of them. There was a blackboard that probably had never been repainted. And although there was nobody there, it was clear that the teacher had built a mound of earth so that he or she could reach the blackboard. June and I stood in the midst of that classroom, nobody else around, and just wept. And we decided there and then that we would come home and we would tell our people and see whether we could help. And in the end, we did. We were able to build a new classroom with the help and generosity of our people. But then, because they built this new classroom, parents wanted their school, their children, to go to the school, and so more pupils came along, and the school roll grew, and there weren't sufficient toilets. In fact, at one stage, I think there were no toilets for several hundred pupils. So I decided that I would make another appeal at our church for toilets for this school. I remember there's one thing that rectors and vicars dread, and that is the letter that falls on the mat which says to the rector or to the vicar, because you know invariably it's going to be somebody complaining. Well, the letter didn't fall on my mat. It was sent to a committee of which I was chair within the church, which said that the rector is giving our money away to Africa, and this is not fair, because we're wanting to build toilets, we're wanting to improve our kitchen facilities. It isn't fair that our money is being given to these people who've done nothing to help us. Well, I just persisted in this campaign to get toilets built for the Chabagashi school, and also to get toilets built for our own church. And let's just fast forward a few years. The opening of the toilets in our church there in Ramsey. And I remember standing up, and Hugh McCurdy, the archdeacon, was going to open them, and reading a letter from the people of Uganda to say thank you for the toilets that had been built in the Chabagashi school. And I pointed out that they were opened at exactly the same time as the toilets in our own parish church, because the people had recognized, contrary to the letter, that we can be a generous people, not only for our own sakes, but also for the sake of others. And it seems so poignant. On exactly the same day, the two lots of toilets were open and provided. In other words, the first and the last both received the same amount of generosity. And that is how God works. Somebody said to me once, you can't outgive God. God gives generously, and he causes us to be generous. And we think, and that's the first and the last, having the same amount of generosity. And I end with this. The context of this story in Matthew 20 is that Jesus is on his way to Mount Calvary, where he's going to pour out his life in death, where he's going to give his life as a ransom for us and for many. Because that is the kind of God we serve. The one who does not give us according to our deserts, or even according to our failures. He is the God of immense love and generosity, who came to this earth in Christ, who died on the cross for us and our salvation, who rose again from the grave. Why? Yes, so that we might be forgiven, but that so that we, moved by his generosity, may learn ourselves to be a generous people. My dear friends, let's loosen our grip. Let us open our hands, and let us share with others, even those we deem to be not our type, the wonderful generosity and compassion of God in Christ. And maybe we too need to open our hearts this morning to receive it for ourselves. Amen.
We'd like to stand as you are able and we should pray for you together. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again,
in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may kneel or sit as Judith leads us in our prayers of hope in session. And his family, James Bowman, Margaret Bowman, George Radcliffe, Audrey Clark, Constantine Bacata, Penny Williams, Hannah Husbands, and Francis Cornell. May they be blessed and helped in their trouble. And they may find comfort in those who minister to them. Safely comfort those who suffer, that they may hope to be through good and ill and trust in thy unfailing love. May we remember those who have died in faith and those who have died not knowing the Lord, and grant us with them a share in thy eternal kingdom. We pray especially for Diane Lee, Peter Leonard, and Annie Human. Comfort those who mourn their passing, Lord. Merciful Father, accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you like to stand for the feast? Christ is our peace, who has made us one and has broken down the dividing wall of hostility between us. Sisters and brothers, and those at home, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
However you do it here, just exchange some form of peace.
We will sing hymn number 769.
Thank you.
the glory, the splendour and the majesty, where everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and that you are open to me. Sisters and brothers, the Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will, and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and singing.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive
forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share. Thank you. Let's give thanks for what we have received. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to our praise and glory. Amen. Sing our final hymn, 818. Oh, hold on. Notices. I have committed the cardinal sin. Notices will now be heard, and then Peter, when they're finished, will sing 818. All right, thank you.
Talking of notices, I haven't actually been given any.
Oh,
has anyone got any notices for us? No? Okay, we better do birthdays. If anyone's going to own up to them. Oh, we have a birthday over there.
John.
How could I forget that? John. So we've got John over here. No one else can own up. Okay, so it's all down to you, John.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and in His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord, in the name of Christ. Amen.